Now, let me start by asking each of these panelists some of the specific implementations or their experiences in some of these technologies that we have seen here. Now, I'd rather probably, if I may, to my left, Dharmendra Shankara, in terms of what is the FinTech Valley doing in terms of leveraging probably a DLT or a blockchain and also enabling the startups to come and build an ecosystem and thus creating something that could be scalable?
WISAC FinTech Valley. One of the things that we are trying to do is build a ecosystem where we're bringing the banking partners, technology companies, investors, and academia together to create the ecosystem that's necessary to leverage some of the solutions the technology companies are coming up with to solve some of the age-old problems that banks have been facing, either be in consumer lending, payments, cybersecurity, or even things like payment dissemination, right? Some of the things that we are trying to do here at FinTech Valley is have the more recent technologies like blockchain. We have partnerships with Black Cactus and Consensus, who are setting up Blockchain Academy to train the new talent that's coming up so that we can use that to solve some of the government problems in terms of blockchain. Some of the areas that we are trying to look at are education and land registry as some of the areas that we are looking at.
Thank you, Dharmendra. So interesting and no-brainer that blockchain revolution started with payments clearance and settlement, and that's what the FinTech Valley is trying to do here. I'd rather next pass on to taking a cue from what Dharmendra said in terms of government applications of blockchain. He talked about education and land registry. In Telangana, she's doing something very interesting with application of blockchain on chit management, if I may. So I'd request Ms. Ramadevi to talk about this, please.
Well, we have developed a roadmap on emerging technologies. You know, we have identified around 8 technologies like IOT, cloud, artificial intelligence, blockchain, AR and VR. And for each of these technologies, we have identified relevant use cases for the departments that actually address certain pain points or improve service delivery to either to citizens or businesses. So, especially in the blockchain, since you have asked me to talk about blockchain, we have identified around 3 to 4 use cases. Like every other country or most of the states are actually implementing blockchain for land records. Apart from that, we have got a very interesting use case. In fact, we were very thrilled and excited by it, which is for chit funds. I don't know how many of you are aware of chit funds business that happened in most of the states. It's a saving instrument for people in the middle income group or lower income group. Like a lot of people save money through these chit fund businesses. And you might have heard that a lot of scams also happen in these chit fund businesses. One example is that of Sharda scam in West Bengal. So realizing that this would be a fantastic use case, which would actually impact the common man, we actually try to find out what are the solutions that are available out there in the market. For us, luckily, we found one startup company called Chitmongs, which is incubated in our own stable, which is T-Hub in Telangana. So in association with Chitmongs, we actually implemented that blockchain solution. It's like, the chit fund businesses is run in the state, which actually covers around 650 companies, amounting to around, I think, around 40,000 crores, something like that, which is just 20% of what Telangana is involved in it. So imagine the amount of, money that's going on in these businesses. So if you can really bring this onto blockchain, all the transactions will be transparent. And the main important thing for the people, it creates trust in the system. As we all know, blockchain actually brings in that, trust into the system because of Its immutability characteristics, where it's not possible to change whatever, you know, or the transactions. So it has been well received by the department also. We have piloted this project. It's being implemented in two departments. So it's a perfect marriage between, you know, the industry and the department with experimenting with a new technology.
Thank you, ma'am. I think it's a very interesting and esoteric use case on applicability of blockchain, but no surprises there. You know, you talked about how to reduce fraud in financial transactions. You talked about bringing trust and transparency and auditability in financial transactions using blockchain. Again, thank you for the nice segue to our next speaker. One of the biggest schemes in India where money is transferred to beneficiaries is the direct benefit transfer. And we've heard of chit fund scams and everything else. I would like to now request Mr. Arun to talk about what is his roadmap. What are you thinking in terms of the roadmap for some of these emerging technologies to make the DBT system even more successful, even more robust, even more inclusive, and even more transparent?
DBT basically involves conditional cash transfers. Now, these transfers are made under various schemes and programs of government. Under central government, there are close to about 430 schemes under which payments are being made directly to beneficiaries. These are cash or in-kind. Schemes such as the PDS or fertilizer, money doesn't reach the beneficiary, but it's an in-kind transfer where government is expending some money, but there is a benefit to the beneficiary. Close to about 2,100 schemes in state governments where money is going to the end beneficiaries. Now, these are identity-linked transfers. And the primary identity that we have currently is Aadhaar. Each of these transfers requires an authentication. The current mechanism of these authentication is centralized. So there is a ping that goes to the CIDR of the UIDI to ascertain the identity of the individual. Now, let me be open about this, that there is no roadmap as such, since you referred to it. This is my own personal view. Government does not have a considered view on either the DLT or distributed ledger technology or any other such. There is obviously some thinking, but it's not a considered view of the government. But the potential application that I see is through digital, through distributed ledger technologies, you can have the identities mapped out in a decentralized manner so that the authentication can be done across the nodes as and when there is a transaction that is added on. And these can be permissioned or permissionless as we make the architecture out to be, so that overall costs and time delays are reduced. And once the identity is ascertained, then the financial transfers can also happen seamlessly in the similar manner. The other applications, obviously, as has been mentioned, in newer records that are being created, land registry is one of the most potential use case scenarios. Death certificates, birth certificates, and there are lots of use case scenarios, but specifically, if you ask me about DBT, then this is what I see as the way going forward, specifically with changing the authentication process from a decentralized, centralized manner to a decentralized manner.
It's again a very interesting concept of moving identity from a centralized into a decentralized manner by looking at establishing the identity of a person through various other facets and in a decentralized manner. We talked, I think, enough on blockchain. So if I may change track a bit, and we have sessions coming up on smart cities. So I would like to ask Mr. Neelkant on where exactly he's seeing some of these emerging technologies happening in the smart cities area. Or if I may, would emerging technologies push our current smart city mission into smart city 2.0? If so, what are the technologies and where do you see the impact?
Thanks for Business World opportunity. Very first, Pimpri Chinchwad is a Detroit of India where Tata Motors, Bajaj, Volkswagen, all these companies in our area. Population is about 2.2 million. And we are in the, rightly said, this round three cities just came last year in the month of June, July. Pimpri Chinchwad have a this using by cloud technology in the IOT, government of Maharashtra with the help of home department. So we have been city surveillance systems where all the CCTV cameras are installed to the various chowks for signaling the traffics. And it is monitored by this centralized control command system by police department, both Pune and Pimpri Chinchwad. Pimpri Chinchwad Smart City Limited now is in the process of implementing some IoT and cloud application with the help of currently we are having this floating the RFP for this passive component of this 750 kilometer laying of optic fiber by own by the means of monetizations. Secondly, the whole city is covered with the 750 hotspots points. Then the kiosk, we say that intelligent kiosk, we have been identified in the 450 spots. The city population, mainly 11% resides in this slums. So the digital empowerment, those who are deprived from this digital technology, where there is no penetration of mobile, where there is no penetration of internet. So a smart city means this, actually this people comes to this digital empowerment. We are giving this facility to them by providing the all type of this citizen services, transactions related to the our city government, all benefits like DBT and all these will be helpful from then setting up kiosks near to the slum and their doorsteps. So they will be part of this digital divide. The by our this control and command center, which is proposed, will having the all these technical details of this cloud computing, where not only our city government talks about the citizens, but it is one type of the integrated with the police, then other authorities, the Maharashtra Industrial Development Corporations, then the transport, then Maharashtra Industrial Development Corporation. All these will be combined and part of this control and command center. And wherever possible use cases is to be given to the police, given to this transport. So everybody get facilitated and citizens having some hassle-free services. Secondly, we are also making our city smart in the way of installing the smart water meters, then the environment sensors, then the SCADA for sewerage. So the environment friendly and the safe city with the help of this CCTV surveillance, various places we are going to implement it. Then the adaptive traffic transport, which is the important project by the using of various IoT devices and sensors implemented by this in the smart city. Lastly, the sanitations and health, that are the important issues. So all these primary and secondary collection system with the GPS, GPRS and using GIS, having dashboard centralized and mobile applications will be get benefited to the citizens. And proudly say that in the Swachh Sarvekshan, which is conducted in the first year, 2016-17, so Pimpri Chinchwad was in the ninth rank in India and first rank in the Maharashtra. So we having the all the solutions of this citizen get the smart solutions facilities, and we are in the phase of implementation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I think you bring a very interesting facet of how do you remove the digital divide, or in spite of the digital divide, how can technology reach all the people who need these solutions So I would rather than pose the question to Mr. Srinivas Rao on what his thoughts are around how digital or digital technologies or some of these emerging technologies can address the needs of all these citizens, irrespective of their economic status or access to some of the digital technologies, or even in the absence of some of the digital technologies like a smartphone. So what's your thoughts, sir, in terms of how could digital transform lives in a country where there is a huge amount of economic divide?
Thank you, Sriram. Actually, 2011 around 12, probably we were the first generation guys started this digital. I am sure who are acquainted with this digital, you heard about SMAC, SOCLOMO, CLOSOMO. There were so many jargons in 2011 and 12. It's like social, mobile, analytics, cloud, or different technologies are came in. And we successfully confused different customers. So what is this SMAC? What is this SOCLOMO, CLOSOMO? Different jargons you guys are using in the Indian IT companies. I was working as a senior vice president at Tech Mahindra and also global head for digital. Then we realized, I think that's not the way to tell the customers a technology language. Okay, we have something great in social, mobile, analytics, cloud, and all. So with that, last 6-7 years of my observation and experience, I realized, if you look at any organization, you have strategic level, tactical, and operational level. So at the strategic level, from this company like BT and BT, that's my startup company, Better Today and Better Tomorrow. So what we realized is there is no common understanding of digital from board of directors to the lowest level of the employee. If you ask the CEO of the company what is digital, he or she has some different definition. Somebody say it is IOT, somebody say it is experience, somebody say it is blockchain and all. So what we thought, the first fundamental thing, the strategic level, there is a different thinking required in the minds of the leadership team. So we introduced something called lean digital thinking. So there are 12 principles we have taken, so that this is a common standard, common language. In the interest of the time, I may not explain all the principles. But why we brought lean? If you look at now, everybody is talking about fourth industrial revolution. Lean in the manufacturing was introduced probably in the second industrial revolution, industry 2.0. But that lean, the context was manufacturing. Now it is fourth industrial revolution. Now it has to be contextualized. In the sense, every digital enterprise must be lean. You should avoid all the non-value-adding activities when you are transforming your enterprise or government to a digital enterprise. That's why we come up with the 12 principles, and that thinking will make from board of directors to the bottommost employee think alike how those 12 principles you can really inculcate. That's point number one. But how do you tell where you are? Today, the major concern, whether it is government organizations or private organizations, what is my current digital intensity? Or where am I? So most of the times, unfortunately, that assessment is not done comprehensively, even in the governments or enterprises. There should be something, the pillars. If you look at business side, before we go to the government, everybody talks about business strategy, business model, business vision, the products, the processes, services, and all. How do you assess all these pillars against these 12 principles? There is a 132-dimensional assessment needs to be done. Is something I have been telling the board of directors and CXOs. My dear friends, if you want to tell you are a digital, don't talk like I have great some robots and I have some artificial intelligence, machine learning and all. You tell me whether your product is digital. You tell me whether your process is digital. Your services are digital. Your operating model is digital or not. Your work environment is digital or not. I think that's the point number one, which I would like to convey here. The second important aspect here is, even in 2012, when I was talking about digital, somebody joked and told, you are talking to yourselves. Nobody understand what is digital at that time. But now I'm sure a lot of people understand that. The most important aspect in the digital, from my experience, is it is fusion of technologies. Unfortunately, we talk about, even here we're talking about IoT, cloud, and blockchain and all. It doesn't work. If I take a problem from the customer, or if I take a problem from the citizens, or any operational problems of the government, how I can solve that problem with the convergence of multiple technologies. In the past, probably I was solving that problem in a different way. I had only two technologies at that time, maybe 5-6 years back. But now I have 7, 8, 9, 10, 20 technologies are there. That's the very complexity of this digital era, right? Augmented intelligence or whatever, artificial intelligence, machine learning, AR, VR, blockchain, so on and so forth. When I bring the power of convergence of these technologies together, can I solve the citizen problems or customer problems differently? What I was not able to solve in the past? I think that is the question what the tactical level leadership needs to ask. How differently I can solve the business problems or citizen problems or customer problems when the power of convergence of these technologies are in? So that's where your solutions needs to be designed by solving the problems with the power of convergence. The innovation lies in the intersection of these technologies, not with individual technologies. Then the third most important thing, what from my experience I observed, even 4-5 years back, one of the organizations we passionately presented Digital X. But when you saw there, your applications are not ready for the digital transformation, the lowest level of the part I am talking of, operational level. First I talk about strategic, second I talk about tactical, and third is, because of these technological innovations, you have operations technologies, information technologies, then communication, collaboration technologies. Today you talk about biotechnologies. That's where I talk about the convergence. So in the past, you look at, you have only the transactional related applications. Process automation was the most important thing in the past. After that, you started getting, because of this technology convergence, how do you engage the citizens? Or how do you engage the customers? How do you emotionally make them happy? So there are so many applications coming in because of the mobile and social and analytics. You are able to understand the persona and happily providing that personalized experiences. Those applications were not there 10 years back, if you really observe. We had only the transactional related applications, the automation of the processes. But today it's not just automation of the processes. You also need to make sure those are all task needs or transactional needs, but you need to look at the human emotional needs also. When the person will get excited, motivated. So those aspects will be taken care of, other set of applications called systems of engagement. And third important thing, you are giving life to things now. Everybody's talking about Internet of Things. Then how do you make sure the applications are built leveraging all these connected machines, things, all these things, right? So that means what is important here as a CIO or a technology organization, you need to look at systems of records, systems of engagement, systems of things. These are all the different sets of applications required to really make your organization digital, not just simply with the transactional application what we talk about. I think these are all the three things I thought as an organization need to look at. A lean digital thinking and assessment of the organization against multiple pillars. And when you want to design a solution, you look at the problem and take the convergence of the technologies and look at, if I bring all these technologies together, can I solve that problem differently, which I was not able to solve in the past? Then you need to have a strategy to have the architecture and applications with different sets of applications, systems of records, systems of engagement, systems of things, of course now systems of insight and analytics. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Srinivas. So how do I say, industry insights coming from the enterprise, which are highly applicable to government. And in this era of one, as I said, converging technologies, it's very easy to talk about and implement compared to a government scenario in the private sector, many of those things coming in. So, you know, I have a couple of questions and we're running out of time. So first question I'll pose to Ms. Ramadevi, asking her, what are the challenges that one has to overcome if you have to implement some of these cutting edge or even bleeding edge technologies and push forward in a government kind of setup, get the buy-in, and what is a roadmap that you portray so that you can get the buy-in and you can start implementing? You know, we're running out of time, so if you could keep your answer short, that'll be helpful.
It's really challenging, you know, when you're actually experimenting with emerging technologies. Say you go to a department and tell them, see, this is blockchain, it helps you in this way, these are the characteristics. There's no way that they can understand it, you know. There'll be certain departments, in fact, who understand it, but at the same time, they say, you know, it's an emerging technology, it's not matured, so let us wait till it evolves, you know, sort of thing. So we are trying hard to convince the departments, and at least, you know, I mean, we are going for POCs because these are new age technologies. So what, finally, some departments, they get convinced, but when we actually want to implement the POC, the biggest challenge that we are facing is funds. If it's an actual, you know, application that's going to be implemented, maybe the departments would come forward to fund the project. But for a POC, that too, using an emerging technology, it's a big no for the departments, you know. I think Chitmongs, which is here, has faced the challenge. So maybe, I don't know if it's right or wrong, I'm just, because the industry is here. If the industry can pitch in using their CSR funds for these POC, it will greatly help the departments. Because ultimately, when we actually scale up the implementation of these projects, you know, we float an RFP and industry will actually respond to those RFPs, right? So that's one challenge. I mean, it's the biggest challenge, I would say, in government organizations. Second is creating awareness. Or a certain role needs to be created, just like in Telangana, you know, actually, I'm actually playing that role. You know, wherein some organizations call it a CIO, but in government, you know, it's there are different names to it. Somebody who can actually bridge the gap, you know, who can understand the technology, understand the government processes or government pain points, and who can actually, you know, sort of bridge the gap and suggest solutions using these emerging technologies, that would be a great thing. And I just, instead of challenges, I would want to say what worked for us for in this chit funds project, you know. First one, I mean, the department was really, I mean, gave a lot of support. We had a person who had both domain experience and knowledge of IT, which greatly helped us. The second point is, I mean, in Telangana, IT department is spearheading all the new projects. So we work like a corporate in Telangana, especially the IT department, you know. So all decisions happen very quickly, and we guide the departments how to go about with this project's execution. Third one is implementation partner. I mean, it was really a refreshing experience for us working with a startup company, you know, in Hyderabad. We could see the hunger, you know, hunger to actually take this project to its logical conclusion. So these three things work for us, you know, hunger in the implementation company. Second one, cooperation from the department. Third one is sort of guiding and handholding by the IT department.
Thank you, ma'am. So that brings a very interesting point. You know, she outlined a lot of bottlenecks and how they went about addressing those systematically. I think I have time for one more question to the panel, and if they allow me, I'll probably open up to one question from the audience. The question which I want to ask the panel is, you know, DBT has been a fairly successful program. It's got huge footfall and a phenomenal amount of acceptance and money getting transferred. So I would not want to ask you how you're addressing the challenges. That's post-facto. You have done it. Now, what are you trying to do to further innovation in this particular program? What is your approach that you take? You talked about DLT for DBT. What is the approach by which you get consensus? How do you get buy-in? How do you go about doing this in a government setup? If you could elaborate in the next 1 minute or so.
Sure. I wouldn't say that we've completed our task. It's still very much in the process. The total DBT budget for central government is something about 4,88,000 crore, as we had calculated last year, of which about 2 lakh crore was done in a DBT mode in 2017-18. So we're at about 50% mark. As I mentioned earlier, we have about 430 schemes in central government and 2,100 schemes in state governments. Now, we've covered the horizontal expansion of these programs across about 57 ministries. What we need to do now is to complete the vertical process, wherein the largest schemes or programs, such as the food and public distribution, fertilizer, agriculture, LPG, so these are, and NREGA, these are some of the top programs which make up for about 80 to 90% of the entire budget. There, I think there is still a lot of work to be done in terms of the contact points that we have across the country. These need to be automated, digitized. That's where DLT, IOT, cloud, etc., these technologies will come up. Some of these at the state level are already being experimented in a small setting. But to move the entire government to that will obviously take time. It's a long-drawn process. But I would agree that in a relatively short period of time, we have achieved quite a bit of success. And I think this is because of the leadership from the top. There's absolutely unanimous backing for this program. Thank you.